Everyone has seen pro wrestling. Everyone thinks they know what pro wrestling is.
I don't know what your injury is,
but there's something you don't know about pro wrestling. This is the other side of pro wrestling. This is independent wrestling.
Jimmy Jack Falk Jr.
My search brought me all the way to the backwoods of Stem, North Carolina, to find out about Gouge Pro Wrestling. My first question was, how did they become pro wrestlers?
Well, in 2000, I signed up for a camp at Dory Funk Jr.'s in Ocala, Florida. Took a step in the ring, and it's been money ever since. It's pretty much all I've ever wanted to do since I was a little Hulkamaniac in 1987.
When I was 15 years old, I was in high school, and a buddy of mine told me about a school that was in Greensboro. And so one night they come and kidnapped me and took me up there, and the rest is history.
Were you a wrestling fan before?
Yeah. Every time Jim Crockett Promotions was at the Coliseum, I was there.
I actually stumbled upon it. It was something I always wanted to do, and I was a baseball freak. That was my passion. Thought I was going to go somewhere with it, and I hurt my shoulder. But I was just searching online, and I came across a federation, you know, promotion right there in my backyard, and they actually were starting a school right then and there. So I honestly didn't think I was going to be a wrestler. I was going to be a referee or something like that, but I just wanted to get into business.
I then wanted to know what kind of accomplishments these guys had.
Biggest accomplishment, I would probably say it was probably February of 2001. I did a six-man tag. It was me, Big Peter Snot, and this other guy. We did a six-man against these guys from UPW, which was down in Southern California. I was in Northern California. And the guys, one of them was Frankie Kazarian. The other was, I think his name was Smooth Billy D. And the other guy was the prototype. Well, the prototype was John Cena before John Cena. So, you know, for people to say, wow, you wrestled WWE champion, you know, that's kind of cool. And it's like, yeah, you know, you wrestled him. And I also wrestled Great Khali, too. So it's like you got these former world champions you've worked in the ring with. And it just gives you a lot of pride to say that you've been in the ring with them, you know, before they made it, you know.
I started SCW. SCW had a nice 10-year run where, you know, the Hardy Boys, Christian and Edge, C.W. Anderson, Steve Corino, Lodi, Lita, the Dupps, you know, Otto Schwantz, Shane Helms, you name it, they came through SCW back in the day, Shannon Moore, and then I ran that for a while. It kind of ran its course. I shut that down a couple years, you know, later. I started Gouge.
What's your biggest accomplishment so far?
Not getting run over by some of the big guys or big ladies in Gouge and SCW. And, you know, working the debut of the North Carolina Wrestling Cartel show. That was a nice moment as well.
Who's the biggest name you've worked with?
Well, I wouldn't say there's a biggest. There's a lot of indie workers that are in indies but don't get the credit that, you know, they deserve. And there's a lot of people in indies that don't get the shots that can do just as good as I do, or wrestle just as good as some of the guys on TV. And they just get more light, you know, light shed on them, they get a chance. It's not always about what you know, it's about who you know.
Let's see, biggest accomplishment or biggest embarrassment. I actually did ECW taping when WWE had ECW. It was in 2007.
Let the bodies hit the floor.
Here is a wrestler that has actually wrestled on TV for ECW only 3 years ago in front of millions of fans.
Oh!
roughly 3 years ago, and I wrestled the Boogeyman, roughly an 18-second match. The Boogeyman.
Making his way to the ring from the bottomless pit, the Boogeyman!
As I still cannot believe the Boogeyman is here.
Weighing 242 pounds, Sean Alexander!
Yeah, me neither. I'll tell you, I'm happy that the Boogeyman...
on television, got squashed, ate some worms, and went home.
His opponent's paranoia. I'm paranoid, and I'm not going to get within 10 feet of the Boogeyman! Ever!
Well, looks like, young Sean Alexander is caught where you don't want to be caught.
Throttled by the throat.
Oh!
And planted. Cover.
One, two, three.
Oh, it's over.
But, you know, it put me out there a little bit.
Oh! Good God! Oh!
Before we go thinking that all wrestling is glamorous and fun, I wanted to find out just how real it is.
Dislocated my left shoulder about three or four times, bruises, cuts, I had a couple black eyes.
A year ago, Jerry Lawler drop kicked me out of the ring and I landed on my elbow. I couldn't move my elbow for a couple weeks.
I am in a constant state of pain for the last 7 years. I've hurt my ankle, I've probably broken my thumb 6 times, shoulders, elbows.
You know, wrestling is not fake. I've nearly broken my leg, nearly broken some other things. Did break this finger. It happens. It's real. I go home with bruises. We're there to put on a show and pull the crowd into our battle in the ring.
I hurt everything on my body. Right now I'm standing here with 2 hyperextended knees and they're wrapped so tight right now I can barely bend them, but hey, gotta do it.
Have you had any injuries since you've been in business?
Several. That's actually why I'm not wrestling tonight. I've broken my left arm. I've had several concussions. Torn cartilage in both knees, ligaments in both ankles. Numerous, back and neck injuries and, pinched nerves, things like that. Broken nose. I can't put into words how physical it is and how much it hurts.
My second match, that was a bad one. That was when I got injured. I wrestled Cowboy Willie Watts again, and it was supposed to be a quick 2 or 3 minute squash match. He was gonna put me in the corner, chop me a little bit, fling me across the ring. I was supposed to do a big hip toss, land on my back, do one flip, land on my back, and he was gonna pick me up and throw me out the ring. So we get there, and he does the chops. I don't remember the chops. You'll find out why in a sec. Because when we did the hip toss, he lifted me, and I jumped. And I don't think he was used to picking up somebody that small. I was small. And he picked me up, and I jumped, and I flew. And I did a complete 450 in the air. Still the craziest thing I've ever seen, even though I didn't actually see it in person. I lived it. And on the craziest thing I've ever seen on tape. And I landed flat on my face at about who knows how many miles per hour. Broke my cheekbone, orbital bone. Just messed it all up. It wasn't good for anybody. I was out of action for like 5 months trying to wait for it to heal up.
So August of last year, the first injury that I got was a busted eye due to a miscommunicated foot blow that I was supposed to take. Had the stitches that happened on a Saturday. Had the stitches taken out the following Friday. Went and did a show Saturday and tore my left tricep tendon, about a 50% tear on that. Had to have surgery. I was out from August all the way to April. So about an 8-month hiatus. Come back, and in my return match, when I actually defeated Seymour for the Gouge Championship, I tore my right triceps, actually about an 85% tear, worse than the first one, in the very last spot that we did in the match. So maybe age, I don't know what it is, but something's telling me that it might be time to hang it up.
I pulled my bicep, back injuries, my leg goes numb every once in a while. My knees are shot, typical stuff. Nothing really bad, except for where I've had surgery, where I had to have fatty tissue from 10 years of it getting hit. And so now I had 18 staples in my head, but other than that, I've been lucky.
The common perception among people is that wrestling is fake. I ask these wrestlers, what do they say to people who think that wrestling is fake?
Everyone can negate until they actually try it. There's been a lot more people to try it and fail than to try it and succeed.
Get in there. Get in there. You think it's fake? It's predetermined. It's not fake. Injuries happen, and you'd really be surprised. Most of these people will crap their pants.
I could say football is fake. You got pads, whatever. I've never played football before, so I don't know. So people who want to talk about wrestling say that it's fake, have them try to be a wrestler. Have them come to a training show. Come train, come be a part of it. Have a wrestler beat them up. You don't know until you've done it. And once you've done it, you'll be like, this isn't fake. I dare someone to try to say that wrestling is fake after they've been in the ring training and getting beat up in a real match. They'd be lying if they said it's fake then.
What do you have to say to people who think wrestling's fake?
Fake? Match might be predetermined, you know, the storyline. But other than that, wrestling's not fake. If you think it's fake, I tell them, you get in there and try it. See how fake it is. You take a chair shot. Tell them how fake it is after a chair shot.
Look at my arms. I'll show you the scars. I think Seymour just injured his leg tonight. It's very real. And when friends of mine ask me about it, they're like, come on, you know, it's fake, don't you? And I say, well, no, it's not fake. I consider it more of a staged act. I mean, the moves are very real. You're just trained to take them. I mean, miscommunications happen on a nightly basis. And, I mean, I got two scars to prove it. So, not real. I mean, not fake at all. Sure.
If you think wrestling is fake, get in the ring with me, because I'm going to tell you. Can I plug my deal?
Sure.
Go to YouTube, type in the Boogie Woogie Man Chop Challenge. Let me chop you one time. You tell me if it's fake.
Independent wrestlers lay it all out on the line for their fans. Even the referees get involved sometimes. And sometimes the referees pay the price. Oh,
for days.
I wasn't done there. I then found out that one of the best wrestlers of all time was coming to EAW Wrestling in Eden, North Carolina. A man who has traveled the world and won tag team championships everywhere. One half of the Rock and Roll Express, Ricky Morton.
Well, I'm one of them guys from the olden days. Now, my name's Ricky Morton. I am one half of the Rock and Roll Express, 8-time NWA World Tag Team Champions. I've wrestled for NWA, WCW, WWE, ECW, and I'm 54 years old and I'm still wrestling.
Ricky's accomplishments are already spoken for, but I want to know a little bit about one of the most dangerous matches in wrestling history, the scaffold match.
We broke every record you could ever imagine. Wrestling attendance for Mid-South at the time for Bill Watts. Mm-hmm. Sold out arenas, buddy. I'm talking about 40,000 people in a Superdome. We had blocked off half of it. It's unbelievable the business we did. But if you noticed, and then when we come to NWA, you guys seen it, it was one of the greatest things they've seen then because then it went nationwide. But you got to understand, you watch, I'm scared of heights. Mm-hmm. What I think about the match, I don't remember because I was too busy holding on. People don't realize how high the scaffold is, man. I mean, when you get on top of the scaffold, you can't even see the ring because you're so high, you got to lean over. And I'm scared of heights. I'm telling you, I hate heights. I want them to get on top of my house. You know, hell no, I'm not going to. Don't ask me. If it's your job to get up there, I'm fired. I'm sorry, man, you got me tickled.
Oh my God, no!
In wrestling these days, people go through tables all the time, but Ricky was the first.
Greatest thing ever, wasn't it?
Oh, yeah.
You see, it wasn't intended to happen. It was the first time that everybody went through a table.
Mm-hmm.
If you notice, you watch the match, it was the smartest thing ever I ever done. You see, because me and Robert were just wrestling these guys, and Randy Savage went to power drive me on the table. When they did, the table broke. Well, if you noticed, I don't know anything about our matches, but it went in two. I laid there. I didn't get up.
Mm-hmm.
See, because it made our self-business. Randy was asking me if I was all right. And I was telling him, yeah. And he said, well, get up. I said, hell no, I'm not getting up. I'm laying here. I just went through a table.
Ricky Morton has been on top of the world, and now he symbolizes what independent wrestling is. Independent wrestling isn't for the big money. It's not for the big arenas, and it's definitely not for the big corporations. Independent wrestling is for the people.
For instance, tonight, if you get a chance, I know there's nobody here, but understand, I depend on independent wrestling for a living. See, I love these people. I love wrestling fans. I love to sit out here and bullshit with everybody. I love to sit out here and listen to them because everybody's got a story. Even you got a story. See, but it's great. And I love it. I depend on it for a living. So when I come out here, I mean, earn a few chances for my match. Don't get me wrong, I'm not going to do this, but I understand and I have fun when I do. But it took years and years because I don't go back here, I don't talk over stuff with people. I listen to the people. They can tell me what they want.
Mm-hmm.
Very easy. So, I mean, that's just what way it's about. It's what our business is about.
This is Jimmy Jack Funk Jr. here.
I'm Seymour Snyder.
I'm Damian Wayne.
Andrea the Giant.
I'm Rex Sterling.
I'm Surfer G. Odyssey.
I'm Count Grog.
I'm Frank Stiletto.
I'm Sean Alexander.
Hi, guys. I'm Ricky Morton of the Rock and Roll Express.
And this is Independent Wrestling.
Thank you.
Oh,
No old school. There ain't no new school. It's just called the right fucking way.
Woo, listen, boogie woogie man here. We gonna be brawling, squalling, climbing the wall. Old time jubilee. Blood gonna flow like wine, baby. Come to our arena. Cause boogie man like Coca-Cola. I'm all over. There ain't no telling where you might see me. Woo, listen, love y'all.